Welcome everyone, and thank you for joining for today's webinar on this first day of the fifth edition of Paris Arbitration Week. I'm very happy to welcome you on this joint webinar organized by Reed Smith and AfricArb on new trends and future directions of mining in Africa. So the event will be structured in two parts. The first part will organize around a round table with our distinguished guest, who I will introduce in a couple of minutes. And the theme will be Mining Africa Post-Pandemic World Dispute Resolution Perspectives. The roundtable will take place in both French and English. I will try as much as possible also to translate the questions I will ask to the speakers so that everyone can at least follow the discussion. So, and then we have the second part of our event, which will take the form of an Oxford Union style debate with debaters and judges, who will be discussing two thought-provocative motions. And this debate, these debates, I would say, will take place in English only. Before we begin, I'd like to cover a couple of housekeeping items. First of all, if you have any questions, please use the Q&A chat box, Q&A box, sorry, on your Zoom platform. That should be down there. And I will try to pick up the questions. If we have time, we'll try to answer those questions. If not, make sure that we will follow up with you via email after the program. Then second, today's program is recorded for note-taking purposes. Then I would like first to introduce Paul-Jean Le Canu, who is a senior counsel and team leader at the International Center for Settlement of Investment Disputes, ECSID, in Washington. Paul-Jean, in addition to supervising around 60 cases under the ECSID Convention and other rules, serves as secretary of the tribunal in arbitral proceedings brought under the various instruments of ECSID, but also in UNCITRAL. Having a very strong interest with Africa, Paul-Jean is a member of the Advisory Council of the Africa Arbitration Academy, and also a co-founder and current co-president of AfricArb, the co-organizer of the event. So we will now present the association, AfricArb. Mr. President, floor is yours.
Merci Clément. Comme AfricArb fonctionne en anglais et en français, je ferai une très brève présentation de l'association dans les deux langues. AfricArb is a group of reasonably young legal professionals with a shared interest in arbitration and Africa. While arbitration and other means of alternative dispute resolution are already well known in Africa, we think they can have an ever more important and efficient role in supporting Africa's economic drive and development by encouraging trade and investment. And based on this belief, we're hoping to create ways and fora to discuss the evolution of arbitration, taking into account the diversity of the continent, by also involving as many actors as possible within and outside the continent, by organizing events like this one, but also trainings and opportunities to network, share ideas, and build bridges between all of those who are interested in dispute resolution in Africa. You can find us on LinkedIn and Facebook, so please stay tuned. We'll soon announce further events and initiatives. And on behalf of AfricArb, but in particular, my AfricArb colleagues who are here today, Clément, of course, Salimatou Diallo, and Guillaume Arreou, I'd like to thank Reed Smith, all of the participants who have joined us this afternoon, and our distinguished panelists. Comme je le disais à l'instant, AfricArb est une association de jeunes professionnels du droit qui partagent un même intérêt pour l'arbitrage et pour l'Afrique. si l'arbitrage est déjà largement répandu en Afrique, nous sommes convaincus qu'il est appelé à jouer un rôle toujours plus important et efficace pour accompagner le dynamisme et le développement économique de l'Afrique, en encourageant notamment les échanges commerciaux et l'investissement. Et c'est fort de cette conviction que nous avons pour ambition de créer des moyens et des lieux pour débattre des évolutions de l'arbitrage, en prenant en compte la diversité du continent, en impliquant le plus grand nombre d'acteurs possibles à l'intérieur et hors du continent, en organisant des événements comme celui-ci, mais également des formations, en offrant des occasions de créer des réseaux, de partager des idées, de jeter des ponts entre tous ceux qui s'intéressent au règlement des différends et à l'Afrique. Vous pouvez nous trouver sur LinkedIn et Facebook. Nous annoncerons d'ailleurs très bientôt de nouveaux événements et autres initiatives. Voilà, donc au nom d'AfricArb et particulièrement au nom de mes collègues ici présents, Clémence, Alimatou, Diallo et Guillaume Areou. Je remercie Brett Smith, tous les participants qui nous rejoignent cet après-midi, et ainsi que nos excellents intervenants. Merci.
Merci Paul-Jean, merci pour cette présentation. Passons maintenant à la première partie de la conférence. So now I will switch to English to introduce the theme of the roundtable and also present briefly the various speakers who have come today to discuss the topic. So starting the Paris Arbitration Week with a conference dedicated to Africa makes actually a lot of sense given the importance the continent has taken over the last years and even decades in the arbitration world. And focusing in particular on the mining sector in Africa is also quite natural. The increased demand for certain commodities and the global disruption caused by the pandemic will naturally result in increase of foreign investment flow to those countries that are endowed with such resources. And the corollary of increased FDI, foreign direct investment, is likely to lie in the dispute resolution arena, including, of course, arbitration. The roundtable brings together speakers representing the standpoints of the main stakeholders of mining projects and mining arbitration dispute in Africa. And these stakeholders are, I would say, well, very familiar to all of you: state entity, mining operators, arbitration institutions, lawyers being transactional or litigators. So, and our speakers also illustrate Africa's diversity of languages and geographies. So the discussion, I hope, will explore some of the hot topics of mining arbitration in Africa, including the questions, for instance, of governance in mining agreements, in mining companies, new trends regarding stabilization provisions in host state agreements, and social and environmental concerns, which are increasingly matter of debate and dispute. So in addition to Paul-Jean, I will have the pleasure to welcome on this table first Abibatou Touré. Abibatou Touré is a managing partner at Abibatou Touré Law Office in Dakar, Senegal. She has over 24 years of experience in investment project and project financing in Africa. A large part of her practice focuses on infrastructure sector, as well as energy, oil and gas, mining, telecom, and so on and so forth. I will not mention every sectors. I mean, she has really a very large experience. And Abibatou also sits as arbitrator in arbitration under the CCJA or the ICC rules. So thank you, Habib, to be with us today. Then moving to Salimatou Diallo. Salimatou is a co-founder and managing partner of the newly established Pan-African law firm ADNA. Her practice focuses primarily on complex project development and project finance, M&A, general corporate and commercial and other matters, principally in the sector of energy and the mining sector in Francophone Africa. Before relocating to Conakry, Guinea, Salimatou worked as a lawyer in renowned international law firms in Paris and London. So thanks, Sally, to be with us today. Then moving to Karifa Condé. Karifa Condé is the general counsel of the company des Bauxites de Guinée, CBG, and is also the secretary general of the board of directors of CBG. He joined CBG in 2005 and has risen through the ranks to be appointed general counsel in 2019. Karifa is also the chairman of the board of directors of the NGO Cercle Droit et Conformité, which brings together managers and officials in charge of legal compliance issues in Guinea, in Republic of Guinea. Thank you, Karifa, to be with us today, and you will be the voice of the users of arbitration and in project and mining disputes. Then I don't know if Kim Bengta has joined us, perhaps not yet, but Kim Bengta will join us hopefully soon. He is the principal state counsel at the Attorney General Chambers and Minister of Justice of the Gambia, where he leads the international arbitration team. He has represented the Gambia in a number of arbitration matters under ICSID, ICC, LCIA rules. He's also instructing counsel for all arbitration matters in which the government is represented by external counsel. And then last but not least, my colleague, Richard Swinburne. Richard is a partner at Reed Smith in London, specialized in commodities. Richard advises energy and natural resources companies, commodity trading companies and banks in connection with all the aspects of the commodities related business, be that financing, trading or transportation of bulk commodities. Richard also handled a large number of trade-related disputes in arbitration at the various commodity trade association, as well as arbitral institutions such as the LCIA and the ICC. So now moving to the discussion we want to have, I will maybe start by asking a question to Paul Jean, try to setting a little bit the scene. So my first question for you, Paul Jean, from your perspective, is it the case that we see a lot of disputes relating to mining projects, and in particular in Africa? So en français, juste avant que tu répondes, de ton point de vue, voit-on effectivement... voit-on de ton point de vue, effectivement, plus de litiges en matière minière et en particulier en Afrique?
Thank you, Clément. And I take this opportunity to welcome Mr. Kim Bengta to the webinar. To answer the question very concisely, yes, there's a significant number of disputes arising in connection with mining projects. And some argue that the number of disputes is likely to continue to be significant in the future. And so what we could do is have a look at the factors that contribute to there being disputes in that sector. And if I could ask perhaps Lucy to pull up the slides and we can go directly to the second slide. So among the factors, and this isn't meant to be fully comprehensive, but we can mention increased mining activity. Secondly, the complexity of mining operations and the associated risk. Thirdly, the multiplicity of actors and relationships involved in mining projects. You can see on the slide an overview of this network of relationships and related activities. You have disputes between the investing mining companies and the host state under investment laws, mining codes, contracts, or treaties. That's what I will focus on, but that is by no means the only type of disputes that we see in the mining sector, and some of my esteemed panelists will address other types of disputes. And so we have disputes involving contractors and service providers, dispute within the supply chain, such as those involving purchasers of minerals. We also have disputes within the joint venture operation. There's usually a joint venture between the state entities and the mining, a state entity and the mining company that can give rise to disputes. There can be also disputes involving third parties, such as local populations who may claim that their environmental human rights are affected by mining activities, and there can be also labor disputes with employees. So a whole range of relationship potentially giving rise to disputes. Then a fourth factor is the high financial stakes in those disputes in this activity in mining activities. It's capital intensive and significant funds are involved. There's also a sensitivity to regulatory change. These are long-term projects. And finally, if we look at the future, commentators point out that minerals and metals play an important role in producing equipment and infrastructure in the renewable energy sector. A number of these minerals and metals are found in abundance in a number of African countries. And so with sustained demand for minerals and metals, including for purposes of the transition to cleaner energy, the potential for future disputes does remain. Now, what do the numbers say about mining disputes? And I will focus now on ICSID arbitration and the extractive industry. So that includes not only mining, but also oil and gas. And if we could go to the next slide. What you see here is the geographic distribution of the entire ICSID caseload. And you see that cases involving African states account for about a fifth of ICSID cases. That's the same proportion as South American cases. Now, if we go to the next slide, and if we look just at the extractive industry cases, the share of cases involving African states is 31%. That's the biggest of all world regions, and the second biggest share being that of South America, with 26% of cases in the oil, gas, and mining sector. We could go to the next slide. Thank you. If we look now at the distribution of ICSID cases by economic sector, so no longer just focusing on one particular region, but all regions, you see that again, oil, gas, and mining accounts for the biggest share of cases among different economic sectors. That's 25%, followed by electric power and other types of energy. If we look now in the next slide at the different economic sectors in cases involving just African states, again, we see the importance of extractive industries. That accounts for 36% of cases involving African states. Interestingly, the same is true for African investors. If we look at the next slide, we'll see that the economic sector with the most cases is again oil, gas, and mining, with 38% of cases. And I'll stop there. I think that's probably enough statistics. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul-Jean. I find it very interesting, those statistics, at least to put some figure in our mind. Although you, I understand that ICSID is not distinguishing between mining and the other extractive sectors, one can say that the mining sector is really one of the most important, I would say, sector for disputes, at least in the ICSID system.
That's right.
In the first slide you put to us, it clearly sets the diversity of the stakeholders in any given mining project, of course. Then the question I will follow up question for you, what are the impact of mining activities which usually lead to a dispute? Can you maybe tell us about that en français? Quel est l'impact ou les impacts de l'activité minière qui conduisent à des litiges ou à des différends?
Merci, Clément. So there's a variety of potential impacts. Mining projects are usually significant foreign investments and can bring economic and social benefits for local communities and the host country more generally. At the same time, as I said earlier, these projects are long-term, complex, very large at times, and as a result may involve certain risks. They can have environmental, social, and human impacts, including on local communities that live in the area where the mining project is developed. And we've heard reports in the news of severe incidents. And so the environmental impact of mining projects the lack of consultations and engagement with local communities, the contrast between the wealth created by mining activities in the surrounding areas, that may lead to tensions or delays in the project, sometimes shutdown of operations, changes in regulations, and that is a potential cause for a dispute to arise and to involve the mining company, the state, and the local population. Now, I understand that some of my fellow panelists will address the steps and initiatives taken by governments and mining companies to address potential risk and foster consultation and cooperation with different stakeholders. What I will do now is give a brief overview of what may happen when disputes have arisen, and how does this translate procedurally and substantively in investment arbitrations. So if you look at the relationship between the state and the investors and the arguments that may be raised at the jurisdictional stage, states may argue that because of the mining investors' alleged failure to abide, say, with certain environmental standards, the investment in dispute wasn't made in accordance with the host state law, and that in turn would deprive the tribunal of jurisdiction. So that's one way the issue could have an impact on the dispute and translate into actual legal arguments. If we look at the merit stage, in the event, say, of termination of a mining concession or a decision to refuse renewal of a mining permit, that is seen as wrongful by the investors, and these may elect to invoke standards that are found in the various instruments, such as provisions on expropriation, fair and equitable treatment, full protection and security. And state may in turn raise defenses that may be based on environmental regulations, human rights, or the rights of local population. A defense may be based, for example, on the state's alleged obligation to uphold the human rights of certain parties. It can be based on the duty to guarantee the rights of consultation of indigenous communities, and on the notion of the social license to operate that the investor should have. It can also be based on the state's exercise of its police powers, say to improve environment protection. It can be based on general exception clauses in the VIT. So these are a few examples of arguments on the merits. If we look at procedural tools, counterclaims may also be used, say to make an argument on the basis of damage to the environment. There, it's important to look at the instrument on which that counterclaim would be based, whether it's treaty or contract. And it will depend on the breadth and wording of the consent clause to the treaty. And finally, I would mention contributory fault as well, which has been used. The argument has been made that there's a causal link between the host state's action and the harm caused to the investment project decreased, and that impact is decreased because contributing actions by the investors to the breakdown of a project. And finally, I would mention the potential participation of third parties as non-disputing parties, if they can bring a different perspective other than that of the parties, then this is a way also to introduce arguments or views relating to the environment, corporate social responsibility, or human rights. And what is interesting to see is how these norms are increasingly visible in more recent treaties. And I think the importance of these issues may well continue to grow, and we'll likely to see these in disputes in the mining sector, at least in investment arbitrations. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul-Jean. Tu as mentionné le rôle des communautés locales et leur implication ou leur plus récente implication dans le cadre des projets miniers. Et effectivement, moi je me souviens par exemple d'une affaire où, dans le cadre d'une transaction avec l'État, l'opérateur minier devait mettre en place un programme de financement de dispensaires. Et le programme était très précis, donc on accompagnait le client dans le cadre de l'exécution de ses obligations envers les communautés, les populations locales. Et donc, je me tourne vers Karifa pour vous poser la question, comment finalement les compagnies minières gèrent-elles les intérêts et les demandes qui sont de plus en plus présentes des communautés locales dans le cadre de projets miniers? Alors, briefly in English, how mining companies deal with the local communities' interest and growing requests in relation to mining projects?
Thank you, Clément. First of all, I notice that this meeting is very helpful for mining company like CBG. I would like to thank Rita Smith. I just precise I'm in a beautiful meeting room of Rita Smith. I feel comfortable to speak in French, so I'm going to speak
Bien sûr.
In French. If necessary, Clément could translate for you. Donc, pour répondre directement à votre question, effectivement, c'est un sérieux problème par rapport à la vie des sociétés minières en Afrique. Vous savez qu'en Afrique, et le cas spécifique de la Guinée, l'État est déficient. L'État n'est pas toujours présent. Et du fait de la déficience de l'État, les communautés ont tendance à confondre les responsabilités des sociétés minières à celles de l'État. Vous savez, dans le cadre de la responsabilité sociétale, les sociétés minières ont toutes développé des départements qu'on appelle « relations communautaires » ou des départements « projets communautaires » qui sont en charge de régler toutes les demandes entre les communautés qui sont impactées par leur opération et la société. Donc, effectivement, si vous prenez le cas des sociétés minières, puisque ce sont des sociétés qui sont en contact direct avec la nature, avec l'environnement, les communautés ont tendance à demander un peu plus. Au-delà des obligations légales et conventionnelles que les sociétés ont, vous remarquerez que les communautés demandent de l'eau, demandent de l'électricité, demandent des centres de santé. Et donc, toutes ces demandes viennent généralement étouffer les opérateurs miniers qui sont dans le cadre de leur permis, de leur convention, qui sont en train de développer leur projet. Et ça impacte beaucoup le développement des projets miniers, parce que vous verrez, mine de rien, pour une demande communautaire, on bloque les opérations parce que tout simplement, il y a un village qui a demandé de l'électricité qui n'a pas eu, et donc la société ne peut pas produire. Donc, pour pallier à ce genre de demande, les sociétés minières, comme je le disais tantôt, ont commencé par mettre en place les départements en charge des relations communautaires. Mais pour le cas spécifique de la société où je suis, nous avons réfléchi, on est allé plus loin. Au lieu de se contenter simplement d'une politique interne de développement communautaire, et au-delà des obligations que nous faisons pour les communautés, nous avons fait une sorte d'assise avec tous les représentants communautaires pour connaître leurs besoins. L'un des premiers besoins que nous avons connus et compris, c'était les demandes d'emploi. Les gens demandent à être employés et généralement, ce sont des personnes qui ne sont pas assez qualifiées. Donc, la première des choses, c'est de faire en sorte que tous les emplois non qualifiés qui pourraient intéresser les communautés, les privilégiés dans ce genre de projet. Et d'ailleurs, vous verrez peut-être quand on va atteindre le financement avec les institutions, ce genre de personnes qu'on appelle les PAP, les personnes affectées par le projet, sont prioritaires pour ce genre d'emploi. Deuxième chose que nous avons mise en place, c'est un fonds. On a mis un fonds pour créer les TPE, les très petites entreprises, et mettre des jeunes venant des communautés dans ces TPE pour leur donner de l'emploi non qualifié et leur permettre de travailler avec la société. Donc, ce qui fait que, en dépit du fait que l'État n'est pas présent ou presque absent, les sociétés minières arrivent à faire en sorte que les demandes communautaires ne puissent pas étouffer les opérations minières. Mais c'est un travail de longue haleine parce que de toute façon, les opérateurs miniers ont leur objectif, les opérateurs miniers ont leur mission, ils ne peuvent pas se substituer à l'État. Mais avec tout ce qui se met en place aujourd'hui, d'ailleurs, vous remarquerez que les communautés sont beaucoup plus appuyées aujourd'hui par des ONG, par d'autres structures de la société civile. Et donc, les miniers aussi s'arrangent à ce que le dialogue soit permanent pour éviter que l'absence de l'État vienne perturber les opérations minières. Voilà. Donc, globalement, le deal qui se fait aujourd'hui se fait à travers un dialogue permanent. Il y a des demandes que les sociétés minières ne peuvent pas supporter, donc qui répercutent au niveau du gouvernement. Mais par contre, il y a des demandes qui doivent être supportées par le gouvernement, mais les sociétés minières le font pour pouvoir cohabiter correctement avec les communautés.
Très bien. Voilà. Merci, Karifa. C'est tout à fait intéressant de voir en pratique, sur le terrain, ce qui est mis en place finalement par les opérateurs comme par exemple votre société. I will now switch to English and will be leaving for a moment the in-country sort of issues to look at the marketing aspect of mineral products, and we'll turn to Richard to ask you, Richard, what are, so from your perspective as a commodity lawyer, what has been the trends on the mining markets after this sort of crazy last 18 months, and whether is it all bad news really in this context? Thank you.
So Clément, good afternoon everybody. So yes, you're right. My perspective on the mining sector is a little different because my focus and a lot of my colleagues' focus is on the commercialization of the product once mined. So I guess if in a, in the world of the energy markets, you'd be talking about the midstream and downstream part of the industry rather than the upstream, which is what a lot of the attendees and the panelists will be focused on. But of course, there is a huge link between those two pieces. The kinds of contracts which typically I and my colleagues will be concerned about will be long-term supply contracts, you know, many years, 15, 20, 25 years, life of mine type contracts between a mine owner, mine operator, and an arm's length third party purchaser of the minerals. So that's one kind of contract. But the other kind of contract, of course, which we frequently are involved in, is a long-term offtake contract. So between the mine owning interests and probably each of those participants as an offtaker, the equity holders, if you like, in the mine as offtakers. So we get involved in those as well, plus or minus finance. You know, frequently the kinds of company I will work for will be acting as lenders as well as off-takers or purchasers of product. And of course, that adds complexity to the legal framework, plus or minus, of course, logistics in-country or logistics internationally. What's, I guess, relevant to what I do versus what a lot of the attendees today will do is that, if you like, the contracts that I've just described are at the crossroads, the intersection between the in-country contracts and the international contracts, which will be governed by an English law or a New York law or a Swiss law or if you like, a compromise law between the producing country and the destination consuming country. And that brings with it all sorts of complexities. So as Paul Jean was mentioning, you know, with these kinds of projects, sometimes it's just the number of actors and the number of contracts which there are to make the whole project viable, which bring the potential for disputes. There's just an awful lot of people and an awful lot of contracts. But also, I think what makes this, and again, the statistics that Paul Jean helpfully shared about extractive industries and their, you know, the concentration of disputes in those sectors is that, of course, there is very often the in-country laws, which then have to be matching or at least fitting together as well as can possibly be with the international laws by which the products are taken to market. And that, again, not through any failure to put the deal together right, but just through the lack in match between the contracts that can cause difficulties. So of course, this is an area that is has huge potential for disputes, and so it's the impact of the domestic law of the producing country and the expectation of the international laws. And if you overlay with that all of the kinds of issue around environmental issues, community issues, compliance issues, which occur in country, of course, if those issues do arise, that's likely to require either the contracts to be changed that interact with those internationally, or it's going to lead to dispute. So, you know, inevitably that crossroads is a really interesting area. So, you know, that's why people like me spend a lot of our time, not only putting transactions together, but then dealing with transactions as they become stressed. One of the trends in the last 2 years, well, I'll just highlight a few. I mean, I guess, you know, the contracts with which I deal are the monetization of the whole mining project. You know, on one view, of course, until the commodities, the minerals are exported and marketed, the whole project is just a cost, a very large cost. And until you can monetize the commodity, You know, there is no profit for anybody. There is no tax to be levied for any country. So, of course, the price, therefore, of the minerals is key. And price volatility, of course, is a factor of supply and demand. And the one thing that COVID has done, of course, is place supply and demand under enormous strain. So if one just looks at the minerals which are prevalent in Africa, and I'll only deal with the major ones, but iron ore, copper, gold, nickel, for instance, all of those, but particularly copper, gold, nickel, they all fell sharply in March, April, May 2020, fell very sharply. But they've all recovered really, really, really strongly. Iron ore, in fact, didn't drop very much, but has risen enormously, but then has dropped very recently a lot. And so a lot of volatility in these really core commodities. If there's volatility, then that, of course, means that the interests of producers on the one hand, consumers on the other, and all of those in the middle are at different, you know, everyone has a different interest. So that inevitably leads to dispute. The dispute could be simply around volumes. Do you operate the mine at maximum capacity, as it were, because the prices are high? Or do you actually go on a go slow because the prices are low? Now, of course, that will have an impact on the commercial interests of each of the parties, and they will turn to their legal rights. So it can be a sort of volume related issue that one sees, or it can simply be, you know, defaults or threatened defaults, or most likely it just means that everybody rather wishes that the price in the contract or the pricing mechanism in the contract said something different to what it in fact says. And so you will end up with the parties seeking to find a way to reopen that pricing mechanism. So I guess, and this is not COVID specific, although COVID has created the environment where we see it, anytime there is big price volatility, one sees disputes in this sector, or at least in this part of the sector in which I operate. So what does that mean in practice? Well, it can mean that, you know, people who used to be very friendly with one another suddenly become a little less friendly with each other and behave a little erratically, using the contract to the maximum to try to put themselves in a good position to threaten a termination or a renegotiation or a claim. So it can be nothing to do with pricing, but they just make life difficult for each other to negotiate. So we see a lot of that. Or it could be, you know, at the opposite end of the spectrum, if you like, a political move by the host country for the mine. You know, they might decide they want a greater share in the tax that is to be generated off the proceeds of the marketing. So you see a sort of political influence at sometimes wanting a renegotiation. And of course, if there's a state company as one of the interests in the mine owning, then you know, query, how does that state, you know, realize its aim to change the dynamic from a fiscal perspective? So we see that. And then actually less probably in the mining sector than in the energy sector, but you see price reopening provisions. You know, these are well known in the gas markets, for instance, lots of disputes about those over the years, but you also see them in the mining sector. So either you see, you know, good wording, which says, you know, with this trigger, the following will happen, and then the parties will, you know, come to a conclusion. And if they don't come to a conclusion, then X will happen or Y will happen. And if worst comes to the worst, Z will happen, which is the arbitrators will set a new price. So, you know, you can end up with, you can have something quite sophisticated, or you can have something fairly vague. And I think in the mining sector, it would be fair to say one sees more vagueness than one sees precision. And that's both a good thing and a bad thing. Lawyers like to exploit vagueness or ambiguity. But on the other hand, commercial parties quite like the room for maneuver that vagueness gives. So we see a lot of price-related disputes, and that's been the case over the last 18 months. And an important thing with these renegotiations is that I think there are some fundamental differences between civil law countries, French law, for instance, and English law, in relation to some of the relevant legal doctrines which can be applied in a price renegotiation. And you know, the two legal systems or take a different approach. So, for instance, in the UK, you know, is there a sort of obligation of good faith in negotiations within contracts? And broadly speaking, the answer to that is no. The English legal system is going a little more in the direction of the civil law system and saying, well, yes, maybe in certain circumstances. And the certain circumstances at the moment are very much in this kind of contract, what they call relational contracts, as opposed to transactional. So, i.e. things that go on a long time as opposed to a short time. So that's very different. In English law, an agreement to negotiate is potentially not enforceable at all. So if you have vague wording in a contract which kind of says the parties will negotiate to about something, quantity, volume, or price, that can have enforceability issues. So one has to be careful of that. So there are a number of areas around price renegotiation where people need to be aware, I think, of the mismatch or the differences. So that's an important thing. I think one of the things that you see or I see around me at work over the last 18 months, which is a challenge for everybody, is that very often we think of as disputes lawyers, we tend to think very often, and certainly I think very often, of it being the end of a relationship. You know, there's a dispute, there's a fight in court or in arbitration, and that's the end of the relationship. If you like, there's a divorce. But actually, of course, in these contracts that we're talking about, either the parties may have fallen out and not be quite as in love as they were once because the environment has changed, but they need to continue to coexist and cohabit, if you like, because they all need one another. They might have to stay together for the children. Exactly, Clément. Yes. So this is a characteristic we see. I mean, I can think in the last 18 months, we've probably had, around me and with me going on some really serious arbitrations, between major players to resolve an issue, price, volume, whatever happens, you know, whatever extraneous factor has happened. But the parties are continuing to do business, and therefore, as lawyers, that poses a real issue because you're having a fight in front of some arbitrators, and on the other hand, you're having to love each other along the side, and that is really interesting. And when that's done well, it means that one party can use its the way it's performing the contract to assist the position it's taking in the dispute in arbitration. If it's done badly, of course, you can end up performing or not performing the contract in a way which is inconsistent with what you're saying in the dispute. So we've seen a lot of that in the last couple of years in parallel, a dispute and trying to operate the contract cleverly to maximize your desired outcome in the dispute. So that's definitely been a trend.
Thank you, Richard. I think we will have to
Go on.
Move on if it's okay. Yeah. Sorry. But thank you very much. That's very interesting to have this perspective also in light of this peculiar period we are experiencing for since the beginning of the pandemic. I will now turn to the sort of contractual framework, and I will switch to French pour poser une question à Salim Atou. Les contrats miniers sont probablement bien connus de la plupart des gens qui nous écoutent. Un sujet qui revient très souvent est celui des clauses de stabilisation, de leur interprétation, de leur négociation. Est-ce que, Salimatou, tu pourrais nous en dire un peu plus sur quelles sont finalement les tendances actuelles relatives à la négociation de ce type de clauses qui sont donc faites pour protéger les intérêts des opérateurs miniers, mais qui sont également regardées de très près par les États. Quelles sont les tendances récentes? And I would just translate into English my question. Stabilization clauses constitute generally one of the main contractual protection for mining companies. So what are the recent negotiation trends in this respect? Merci, Sally.
Merci beaucoup, Clément. Merci, Africa. Merci, Reed Smith, de nous accueillir sur ce webinaire très intéressant. Je vais donc faire ma présentation en français, ce qui est assez rare pour être souligné. Donc, je pense que ce qui est important dans les sujets dont on a discuté, c'est d'abord de rappeler ce que c'est qu'une clause de stabilisation, même si beaucoup de nos auditeurs savent déjà ce que c'est. Donc, une clause de stabilisation, c'est une clause qui permet, dans le cadre d'une convention minière dont les durées moyennes sont entre 20 et 30 ans, donc ce sont des contrats qui sont relativement longs, de geler à un moment donné le régime juridique qui est applicable aux parties à la convention minière. Donc, le plus souvent, c'est à compter de la date de signature, ça peut être parfois à compter de la date d'entrée en vigueur, mais en gros, les parties décident de geler le régime juridique applicable à un moment X. Ce qui fait l'objet de négociations très poussées et souvent très tendues lors de la négociation de la convention minière, c'est l'étendue, donc le scope de la clause de stabilisation. La société, par exemple, la société minière va chercher à avoir la clause de stabilisation la plus large possible, pendant que l'État va chercher à la restreindre au maximum. Donc, en pratique, ça se traduit de la manière suivante, c'est-à-dire que la société va vouloir que toute la la réglementation qui est applicable à la date de signature du contrat soit gelée pour assurer au maximum la protection de son investissement. Et à contrario, l'État va lui essayer de réduire au maximum le champ d'application de la clause de stabilisation pour la réduire essentiellement aux matières fiscales et douanières. Ce sont ces deux matières qui sont la plupart du temps stabilisées. Donc, ce qu'on peut voir dans le cadre de l'évolution de la négociation de ces clauses de stabilisation, c'est que dans les très vieilles conventions minières, et je pense que mon cher compatriote, M. Condé, pourra également apporter son point de vue dessus, c'est qu'on avait avant des clauses de stabilisation qui étaient extrêmement larges, où toute la législation en vigueur au moment de la signature du contrat était gelée. Et aujourd'hui, on évolue vers des clauses de stabilisation où c'est quasiment uniquement les aspects fiscaux et douaniers qui sont gelés. Donc, ça, c'est un point assez important de l'évolution qu'on peut noter. Le deuxième point très important, c'est qu'on exclut de plus en plus les aspects environnementaux et les aspects droits humains de la clause de stabilisation. C'est-à-dire qu'on va considérer que tout ce qui est nouvelle législation en matière d'environnement ou en matière de droits humains ne vont pas être gelés, donc ne vont pas être applicables dans le cadre de la clause de stabilisation et donc toutes les nouvelles législations vont s'appliquer à la société minière. Donc ça peut parfois donner lieu à certaines difficultés d'application des clauses de stabilisation. Par exemple, si on a une convention qui est stabilisée d'un point de vue fiscal et qu'il y a des nouvelles taxes environnementales qui entrent en vigueur, ça peut poser des questions d'application. Dans le sens où, par exemple, normalement, la société minière n'est pas censée se voir imposer de nouvelles taxes, mais vu que c'est dans le domaine environnemental, est-ce qu'on considère que ces nouvelles taxes s'appliquent ou ne s'appliquent pas? C'est des sujets qui ne sont vraiment pas évidents à gérer en pratique. Et donc, il faut avoir une approche qui est plus pragmatique, finalement, que purement juridique dans ce contexte-là. Nous, ce qu'on fait souvent avec nos clients, c'est que donc effectivement, d'un point de vue juridique, ces nouvelles taxes environnementales ne leur sont pas nécessairement applicables, mais en pratique, c'est difficile dans leur relation quotidienne avec l'État de refuser de les appliquer. Et donc, souvent, ce qui se passe, c'est qu'on applique ces nouvelles taxes environnementales tout en réservant les droits de la société minière dans le cadre de la clause de stabilisation plus généralement. Donc, ça, c'est pour moi les évolutions vraiment les plus récentes qu'on voit et qui donnent lieu donc, parfois à des contentieux, à des arbitrages dans le cadre de la mise en œuvre de ces conventions. Voilà.
Merci, Sally. Je Je me tourne du coup vers les autres participants pour avoir un peu leur avis sur cette question des clauses de stabilisation et les tendances qu'on peut tirer. Salim Atou, on a souligné certaines. Abibatou, est-ce que vous auriez également un point de vue sur cette question et notamment peut-être aussi l'interprétation que les tribunaux arbitraux peuvent donner à ces clauses dans les litiges miniers?
Tout à fait, Clément, merci. Effectivement, quand on regarde la typologie des litiges qui arrivent et que Jean-Paul a un peu brossé en introduction, on se rend compte que souvent, la stabilisation repose soit sur une convention minière, soit sur une loi minière qui la prévoit. Et les litiges naissent parce qu'il existe un décalage entre le droit minier d'une part et la convention. Excusez-moi, je pense que je vais mettre le diapo. Le litige existe entre le droit minier d'une part et la convention qui est l'acte fondateur de l'opérateur et l'évolution du droit local qui, pendant la durée de cette convention, qui est une convention de longue durée, va évoluer et se mettre à jour et s'adapter à un environnement international ou à une mise à jour de certaines normes. Et on remarque que l'interprétation devant les tribunaux dépend de la source du litige. En général, une clause de stabilisation qui a une source de divergence fiscale, c'est ce qu'on a le plus dans la sous-région, notamment au Mali, en Mauritanie, au Sénégal, que je connais bien. Vous avez des litiges assez importants, dont un ou deux en cours d'ailleurs au Sénégal, sur des interprétations d'une disposition fiscale. Il est beaucoup plus rare maintenant de voir une divergence liée à la stabilisation de clauses en matière environnementale et sociale, et ce que disait Sally, c'est très vrai. Nous avons même eu des cas où, en fait, la société, spontanément, n'a pas essayé de discuter l'extension des obligations, non pas des taxes, mais d'obligations en matière environnementale, sécurité, pendant la phase d'exploitation, même si le code minier ne le disait pas. Pourquoi ? Parce qu'aujourd'hui, vous avez une nouvelle génération de codes miniers et les États tendent à quasiment obliger ou pousser les opérateurs à basculer vers ce nouveau régime du code minier, je pense au Sénégal avec le code de 2016. Et il existe également des avenants qui sont négociés parfois pour mettre à jour certains aspects de ces conventions avec des exclusions claires, hein, notamment en droit du travail, en droit de l'environnement et du droit des communautés. Pourquoi ? Parce qu'aujourd'hui, le pragmatisme veut que le bras de fer devant un arbitre ne se justifie que si vraiment la bonne foi et le pacta sunt servanda sont clairement bafoués d'une manière claire et sans ambiguïté et avec des conséquences financières extrêmement importantes. Autrement, on négocie. Ensuite, il existe des changements de loi qui ne doivent pas affecter la convention. Donc souvent, l'opérateur privé est à l'aise parce que les jurisprudences en matière arbitrale ont déjà indiqué que si la matière objet du litige était déjà exclue par la clause de stabilisation, à moins de négocier un accord, l'État ne peut pas forcer l'opérateur à appliquer cette nouvelle charge fiscale ou cette nouvelle obligation en termes de comportement. Et il peut se voir octroyer des dommages. Je pense notamment à un litige qui a été largement diffusé, qui s'appelait Somilo, au Mali, où la clause de stabilisation n'était pas très claire, l'interprétation de l'État n'était pas très claire sur l'application d'une nouvelle taxe. Ils ont exigé des taxes, il y avait des soucis de TVA et des soucis d'autres types de redevances. Et l'État du Mali a été condamné sur un point à ne pas exiger le paiement de cette taxe-là qui n'existait pas au moment de la signature du contrat. Parce qu'in fine, ce que retient les tribunaux arbitrés, c'est que cette clause a pour objet une sécurité juridique et à un encadrement des engagements des parties. Donc, le comportement des parties pendant l'exécution du contrat ne doit pas la vider de sa substance. Et ce que je relève en filigrane des quelques publications de décisions, c'est que les États et les parties doivent bien réfléchir avant d'aller devant l'arbitrage, car si la clause n'est pas très bien rédigée et comporte une ambiguïté en faveur d'une ou d'autres des parties, la meilleure option, ce serait de renégocier vraiment en bonne foi pour permettre la poursuite de la relation et du projet et ne pas rentrer dans un bras de fer coûteux qui, in fine, va, sur la mise en œuvre des principes, donner lieu à des décisions quand même qui peuvent parfois surprendre en 2020, mais qui sont lues et interprétées en fonction de d'accords et de droits qui existaient en 2000, en 2005 ou en 2003. Voilà, Clément, ce que je peux dire pour l'instant sur, sur, cette, sur ce thème-là.
Merci beaucoup, Abby. So we got the standpoints from the lawyers, either being the drafters of the contracts or maybe the litigators also then fighting over the interpretation of those stabilization clauses. I would be very curious to have the state sort of point of view. And I'm turning that to Kimbeng Ta. Thank you for joining us. I know that you had an emergency to deal with just before. So I'm glad that you're able to make it. So on it, with your perspective, what are the recent trends regarding stabilization clauses in agreements being entered into with states?
Oui, bonjour Clément, bonjour chers collègues, merci beaucoup. I hope I'll not be very controversial because speaking on behalf of the state, I probably have a view which diverges significantly from the possibly investor perspective. From the state perspective, stabilization clauses are viewed with some sort of disdain and some sort of suspicion because clearly states usually want a certain measure of flexibility and certainty in the lawmaking process, as well as not wanting to be tied for many years, like the length of the licenses they issue. So obviously the trend we've seen generally is that in the past, stabilization clauses were for the greater part ignored by African states. I speak for my country, I speak for a number of states I've worked with, and I know that stabilization clauses are very often ignored, but now increasingly with the rise of arbitration and stabilization clauses, states are paying more attention to stabilization clauses. But stabilization clauses are like the Catholic wife you cannot divorce. They are there and they are not going anywhere. So states are now learning how to deal with them. And mostly it's through seeking to amend these stabilization clauses to make them more favorable to the state perspective. And what we've seen recently is amending stabilization clauses, not just to make them broad to cover all loss, but sort of putting thresholds for laws that could be covered by stabilization clauses. And I worked on one recently where, for example, instead of a 5% loss in the projected revenue or projected profits, there was a renegotiation for stabilization to only kick in once the threshold of the loss increases by around 25% of the loss. So that's a new method. We actually see new trends in which certain governments are vehemently stating that environmental laws will not be subject to stabilization. And we know the mining sector, the sector that's very heavy on the environment, it's environment intensive. But then again, with the increase in environmental consciousness and the move, the climate change and everything, states are now increasingly saying no, stabilization clause will apply to everything, but not to changes in environmental law. That's proven very controversial. And as a result of that, states have sought to use legislation try to override the stabilization clause. We've even seen states try to use the constitution, environmental provisions in the constitution to seek to sort of override these obligations on the stabilization clause. And obviously that has led to significant litigation. But most interestingly, the areas on the stabilization clause where we really see a lot of increased litigation comes most specifically when it comes to fiscal matters, increase in taxes. Increasingly now we're talking about VAT, the new trend of a switch from sales tax to VAT. And the imposition of new VAT laws has led to an increase in mining disputes for most of the tribunals, especially where it comes to VAT of such high thresholds like 12.5%, which has a high tendency to reduce profit. But then as a previous speaker, I think Madame Touré said, there are different areas under which in Africa where we see the rights of stabilization clauses, which are not contractual. In most French-speaking countries, for example, Cameroon, Cote d'Ivoire, Guinea, you see a trend of mining codes containing stabilization clauses, which apply automatically for all investors. But now under common law countries like Gambia, Nigeria, you see something under the constitution, which we call the principle of acquired rights, where if you have an acquired right as an entity, especially for mining companies registered under the countries and therefore domestic entities, once you acquire a right, you cannot be disposed of that right. It's a constitutional right. So we are seeing all those principles of acquired rights under the constitution. So generally, yes, stabilization costs are here to stay, but then there's huge resistance from state, which I think will always end up in more arbitration.
Thank you, Kimbeng. It's quite enlightening to have also the perspective from a non-Francophone country, but also with the specificity of having common law, at least traditions behind that. Now, finishing my little tour on stabilization clause, je vais revenir vers vous, Karifa, pour avoir un peu votre perspective donc d'opérateur minier sur ces clauses et peut-être nous parler également des autres moyens de protection qui sont mis à la disposition des acteurs, des différentes parties à un projet minier, notamment par les prêteurs, par les sponsors et les institutions financières internationales. Ah, vous êtes en mute, Karifa.
Je disais que je précise juste pour finir ce que Salimatou a dit, c'est que les clauses de stabilisation sont en train d'être beaucoup plus réduites dans les conventions. Au départ, si vous prenez des conventions minières, pratiquement elles étaient toutes stabilisées, mais au fur et à mesure, les gouvernements deviennent un peu plus allergiques. On oublie un peu le contexte dans lequel les conventions sont négociées et signées. Et donc, ces clauses sont en train de se réduire et de se limiter seulement aux aspects fiscaux et autres. Effectivement, c'est un travail, c'est un combat généralement entre les opérateurs miniers et les différents gouvernements, surtout en Afrique où la stabilité politique n'est pas toujours garantie. Et les clauses de stabilisation dans les conventions minières souffrent beaucoup plus. Si vous prenez une vieille convention des années 80, des années 70, qui a une clause de stabilisation notamment fiscale, et avec l'évolution législative à l'interne, vous voyez toujours les nouveaux gouvernements qui disent « Non, mais nous ne pouvons pas comprendre comment une société vieille de 20 ans, de 30 ans peut continuer à dire « Non, je ne suis pas soumis à telle législation ou à telle autre ». Donc, et ce qui fait que généralement en Afrique, vous remarquez souvent des comités ministériels qu'on crée pour la revue des conventions minières pour essayer de renégocier ces clauses-là. Effectivement, les sociétés qui ont opté pour des financements des institutions internationales ont trouvé d'autres astuces, d'autres moyens juridiques pour davantage garantir les clauses pour davantage garantir leurs conventions et surtout les clauses de stabilisation. Si vous prenez les institutions internationales de financement telles que l'IFC, par exemple, quand elle veut accompagner un opérateur minier, il y a ce qu'on appelle dans les documents à donner, que l'IFC appelle les material documents. Ce sont tous ces titres, toutes ces conventions, tous ces documents de base de la société que les institutions ont besoin et elles doivent s'assurer que c'est que d'abord la société qui va prêter de l'argent est en règle vis-à-vis de la législation nationale, est en règle vis-à-vis de ses obligations par rapport à sa convention. Vous savez que les conventions minières, généralement, en tout cas pour le cas de la Guinée, ce sont des conventions qui suivent la procédure normale des traités internationaux, c'est-à-dire qu'elles sont négociées par les gouvernements, elles sont adoptées au niveau de l'Assemblée nationale, elles sont ratifiées. Donc, dans la hiérarchie des normes, elles viennent après la Constitution, mais bien avant les lois nationales. Donc, les institutions de financement prennent ces documents tels que les conventions minières, tels que les différents permis miniers, tels que les différentes autorisations administratives qui sont données aux sociétés, pour les cristalliser, c'est-à-dire que les prêteurs vont dire à la société et aussi au gouvernement concerné, tous ces documents-là de base de la société ne doivent subir aucune modification durant tout le processus de prêt et jusqu'au remboursement. Il y a même des délais au-delà du remboursement. Pour subir une modification, les parties que vous êtes, vous ne pouvez pas le faire sans l'aval des prêteurs que nous sommes. Donc, ce qui fait que la chance dedans, c'est que les opérateurs miniers qui sont acculés par les différents gouvernements pour dire « Non, vous avez une clause de stabilisation qui est un peu léonine » parce que c'est ce qui se dit aujourd'hui dans les rouages des gouvernements, que les miniers sont des multinationales qui viennent dicter leurs lois aux gouvernements qui n'ont pas le choix que d'accepter. Donc, ils négocient les clauses en leur faveur, c'est pour ce qui n'est pourtant pas le cas, parce que généralement, l'investisseur, quand il vient, le gouvernement librement accepte de lui donner certains avantages pour garantir son investissement. Donc, lorsque les opérateurs qui ont eu besoin des financements des institutions internationales rendent ces documents-là aux prêteurs, les prêteurs notifient aux différentes parties, donc à la société, mais aussi au gouvernement, que ces documents ne doivent subir aucune modification sans l'aval des prêteurs. Ça, c'est d'abord la première des choses. La deuxième chose, c'est que au-delà de la force obligatoire des conventions, les prêteurs demandent souvent aux différents gouvernements concernés de leur faire des engagements qui permettent aux prêteurs de s'assurer qu'il n'y aura aucune velléité de changement unilatéral de ces conventions. C'est ridicule de penser qu'une convention peut être changée unilatéralement, mais dans le contexte, en Afrique par exemple, où il y a une certaine instabilité, c'est possible, hein. Mais un diktat et puis on vous dit que vous devez venir négocier une clause, pourtant qui est stabilisée. Voilà, donc pour le cas des sociétés que je connais, les prêteurs demandent en plus de la garantie de ces documents, ils demandent aussi à ce qu'il y ait des lettres de confort. Donc ce sont des engagements qui viennent de certains gouvernements qui disent, parce que c'est la seule façon d'accompagner les sociétés pour réaliser leurs projets, alors qu'ils disent aux prêteurs, oui, vous pouvez avoir confiance à ces sociétés, vous pouvez leur donner l'argent nécessaire pour réaliser leurs projets, et ces documents-là qui sont à votre niveau ne subiront aucune modification venant de la part du gouvernement, par exemple. Donc ça vient renforcer davantage les clauses de stabilisation qui sont, comme je le disais tantôt, qui sont en train de s'amenuiser pour revenir au niveau purement fiscal. Et pour ceux qui connaissent un peu l'évolution, les lois fiscales sont en perpétuel changement. De chaque fois, quand vous prenez le code, si je prends le cas de la Guinée, le code général des impôts, les fiscalistes, le gouvernement était obligé de l'actualiser parce que le code général des impôts qu'on avait n'était pratiquement que l'ombre de lui-même. Les lois de finances qui sont venues tantôt deux fois dans l'année ont radicalement changé les dispositions du code général des impôts. Donc, il y a des nouvelles législations qui arrivent tout le temps. Et donc, les sociétés minières, les opérateurs miniers profitent toujours de leurs projets qui sont financés par les institutions pour davantage garantir leur arsenal juridique dans les conventions minières qui bénéficient des clauses de stabilisation.
Merci beaucoup, Karifa. C'est tout à fait intéressant de voir comment ça se passe en pratique et ces types d'astuces, hein, pour reprendre votre expression, les techniques contractuelles qui existent. J'ai conscience qu'on est un petit peu serré au niveau du temps. And I will switch to English now. We are a little bit constrained by the timing. What I suggest is that I would just take one question because it's really the question regarding the news, actually, and I wanted just to have maybe the views of one of you. And then I suggest that we will pass to the next part of our conference today. And I'm sorry that we have not covered every issues we wanted maybe to cover. Just one question from the chat, and I will ask you that maybe to you, Salima, Salima too, and I read it in English, and you will understand why I think it's quite maybe in the news, in light of the recent military coup in Guinea. How will that affect various mining projects and the upcoming projects? So again, I don't require a specific, a very precise answer, but what's at least your reaction as of now?
Yes, so I will answer to the question in English because thank I you. Saw it was it was sent by an English speaker. Obviously, we have a big news in the country, and it's been 2 weeks now since the coup. I think the general feedback we have on the ground is that the situation is quite under control. And the new, the military junta has been giving a lot of positive signals to the mining companies and to the business operators in general in country to make sure that business continues in country. I think the reopening of the borders within 24 or 48 hours after the coup d'etat was a very good sign for the investors that people can still come into the country and be safe. So there was some consultations with the mining operators last week in Conakry, and I think the feedback was also quite positive, and that the government, the current government, has given some good news to the investors in relation to the continuity of the state. We say in French le principe de continuité de l'État, and that all the international obligations of the state, all the agreements, will remain binding on the Republic of Guinea.
Thank you, Salima, too. And thank you, really, all of you, to have participated in this first roundtable, first part of the event. And again, I would have liked us to cover much more issues and topics this afternoon, but we have to move on. So let's move on to the second part of the program, which is this Oxford Union-style debate. Two pairs of debaters will now will discuss two motions, and each of the debaters will have 7 minutes to present his or her position. And I will inform the debaters 1 minute before the end of the allocated period of time, so that they know that we have to wrap up. After each debate, our two judges will have the floor to ask questions to the debaters and make any observations. An important point I'd like to make: for the purpose of these two debates, the tribunal, so the judges, and the debaters are all role-playing. And thus, none of the views expressed during the debates should be attributed to any of the individuals participating in the debates, their respective firms or institutions, or any of the clients. So before we start, let me briefly present our speakers, and starting with the tribunal, so to say. So we have Justice Fatsa Ougergouz, is a Franco-Algerian independent arbitrator with over 30 years of experience in international law, including more than 25 years of practice in international justice matters, arbitration, mediation, and conciliation. Justice Ougergouz was judge and vice president of the African Court on Human and People's Rights in Arusha, Tanzania, president of the United Commission of Inquiry in Burundi, and secretary of the International Court of Justice in The Hague. Thank you very much, Justice Ougergouz, to be with us today. Justice Ougergouz, we have my colleague Anna Atala. Anna is a partner at Ritz-Bish in Paris, a member of the Paris and the New York Bar. Anna focuses a practice on litigation and international arbitration in various fields of commercial law, investment arbitration, and international criminal law. Her experience includes, just to name a few, shipping, maritime law, attachment proceedings, conservatory and enforcement measures, international trade law, insurance and transportation. Then turning to the debaters, we have Amani Khalifa. Amani is a counsel in Freshfields Dispute Resolution Group and an arbitration specialist. She's based in Dubai. She's an Egyptian national, and she has handled several large and complex disputes in the MENA region relating to major projects involving real estate developments, infrastructure, technology, and oil and gas. Amani sits frequently as an arbitrator in the MENA region. And last but not least, and that's something I didn't know, she's also an arbitrator on the Basketball Arbitral Tribunal, an independent tribunal recognized by the Fédération Internationale de Basketball. Then we have Jacquel Ferris. Jacquel is a director at Clifford Decker Ommeyer Inc., a leading African South African law firm. Jacquel is an experienced attorney providing dispute resolution, risk advisory, and regulatory service to clients in South Africa and various other African jurisdictions. And Jacquel has a particular experience in the mining, energy, and natural resources sector, acting for both the private sector investors, but also state and state-owned companies. Then I'm turning to Andrew Tetley, another of my colleagues in Paris. Andrew is a partner at Reed Smith, French avocat and English solicitor with very large experience in commercial litigation, international arbitration, and project work. Andrew previously practiced for over 10 years in New Zealand as a barrister and solicitor after having spent a number of years in a solicitor law firm in the UK. Since 2015, Andrew has been the New Zealand member of the ICC Court of Arbitration and has reviewed hundreds of ICC awards in this capacity. And Andrew has also particular experience in French-speaking Africa countries, where he has assisted clients in many different matters. And then Guillaume Areou, the last of the colleagues I have today around me. Guillaume is also a French avocat and a member of Reed Smith Shipping and Transportation Group in Paris, advising clients on international arbitration matters. And with a particular interest and focus on Africa, Guillaume holds a PhD in international investment law from the University of Nice Côte d'Azur. And alongside Paul-Jean and myself, as you may now know, and also Salimatou, Guillaume is a member of AfricArb. So I'm sorry I've been too long speaking now. So let's have the debate taking place. So there will be the first motion, which I will read out. There should be no limit to a state's right to enact tax and custom regulation in the mining sector. I think, Jacquel, you'll be the one defending the motion. So, Jacquel, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Clement. So the motion I'm submitting would be in support of the contention that there's no limit to a state's right to enact tax or customs regulations in the mining sector, which we specifically focus on Africa, but generally speaking. So my first contention and submission is that, having regard to the sovereign right of a state within its jurisdiction to regulate in the public interest, the state has the right to determine taxes and customs in relation to minerals that are exploited within its jurisdiction. And maybe we must just take a step back in relation to the history, specifically from an African perspective, in terms of natural resources and sovereignty over natural resources. So if you go back to the 1960s or pre-1960s, we had various African colonies where mining operators or multinationals operated in the continent. And at that point in time, there was a question about when there was independence from the Western countries of the colonies, the sovereignty question about who should control the natural wealth and resources of those particular colonies or old colonies. And as a consequence of a debate between the Western countries and also the African states, colonized states, we have a resolution that was adopted by the United Nations in 1963, December 1963, resolution 1803 on the permanent sovereignty over natural resources. And that resolution on permanent sovereignty over natural resources provides that states and international organizations shall strictly and conscientiously respect the sovereignty of peoples and nations over the natural wealth and resources in accordance with the Charter of the United Nations and the principles contained in the resolution. So there are several principles that are contained in articles in the resolution, and the most important is maybe in relation to the right of the state in relation to the exploitation, development, and dispossession of natural resources, the right to dictate who can come and invest as a foreign investor in that jurisdiction, the sharing of profits, and related issues. One of the other important portions of the resolution, it also provides that natural resource projects shall be governed, and this is important, by national legislation in the territory where the projects are located, and obviously take into account international law obligations of the state within the realm of customary international law and international law. So while the resolution 1803 essentially adopts the viewpoint of former colonized states, it also includes certain guarantees for foreign owners of natural resources projects located within those jurisdictions. And in this regard, we can also see that the resolution actually paves the way for the current system of investment protection that we find today under international investment agreements. And you can see that in Article 8 of the resolution, where it also specifically refers to foreign investment agreements freely entered into by or between foreign states shall be observed in good faith. Now, the importance of this is, again, recognizing the sovereignty of the state, that the state may regulate how resources are exploited, and also what taxes or royalties or other forms of levies may be imposed on the resources exploited within its jurisdiction. Only where the state, again, as a sovereign, freely agrees in a contract, whether it's in a BIT, whether it's an investment agreement or concession, and in that agreement there's a stabilization clause, then you detract or reduce essentially what the state can do. And the state is bound to the principles in the contract based on the principles of Pacta Sunt Servanda. So we can also see this in the case of Texaco Overseas Petroleum Corporation, where the tribunal in that case is, though the state has certainty to issue decrees, a state cannot invoke its sovereignty to disregard commitments freely undertaken. So again, it's about, so the state has the sovereign right to dictate within its territory, again, in this case, taxes, but if it has freely entered into a contract to restrict those rights, then it has to abide by that. And what it further says, it cannot make null and void the right of a contract party which has performed its various obligations under the contract. Now, obviously, importantly, for any African state, it's important to attract investment. And having the resources, you need the investment and capital and skills. So what has happened pursuant to the resolution of 1962, various domestic policies, domestic legislation, and also bilateral investment agreements and concession agreements were concluded with other companies directly or with other countries. In those agreements and commitments and legislations, you find tax incentives to attract foreign investment into a jurisdiction. But again, those are the state voluntary enacting legislation, concluding agreements to attract investment. So if you incentivize an investor to invest in your jurisdiction based on the incentives and you gave those commitments, then obviously you cannot renege on it. But generally speaking, there's no restriction on the sovereignty of a state to determine its taxation in relation to the exploitation of its resources. And you can also see this with reference to what has happened during the commodity supercycle, where there was a surge in the metals and minerals prices.
1 minute left.
And, sorry, Clement?
1 minute left.
One minute left, sorry. And you'll see that a number of other jurisdictions, Australia, impose or propose super taxes in relation to shares and profits stemming from coal and iron ore. Even other countries in Africa also pursuant to that imposed or proposed to impose taxes in relation to that. One point I must maybe make is there's three cases, just to emphasize the point. If you look at the case of Revere Copper and Brass, there was a stabilization clause in the agreement, and the Jamaican government imposed taxes or further taxes in violation of the stabilization clause. There's another case of Enakana Corporation where the tribunal said that it was noted that foreign investors do not have the, in the absence of a commitment from the host state, any legitimate expectation that tax regime will not change. And that's with reference to indirect expropriation. Then you have another case against the government of Mongolia, where it dealt with windfall taxes in relation to also during the super cycle, where the government imposed significant taxes on profits. And the tribunal also in that case is the introduction by Mongolia of windfall taxes, amongst others, were compatible with the FET standard established under the Mongolian Russia BIT. So it's just an emphasis again of the state's sovereign right to impose taxes, but if you've made commitments, those commitments must be complied with under the principle of pacta sunt servanda.
Thank you, Andrew. That's for you now.
Thank you. The motion is that there should be no limit to a state's right to enact tax. That is an extremely broad motion. In this debate, I am against it, and I will, in the time allotted, address three reasons why I say that is the case. The three reasons, in summary, are first, what I just call the sheep shearing principle, le principe de la tente de mouton, founded not in law, but on the arguably more solid foundation of common sense. The second reason for rejecting this motion lies in the effect of multilateral and bilateral treaties and ancillary instruments of international law underpinned by the existence of international arbitration. The final reason for rejecting the motion, and I put my house here in the same space as my contradicteur, but for a different reason, lies in the principle of international law, the principle of permanent sovereignty over natural resources. Turning first to the first reason and the sheep shearing principle. Now, this, I say, is a principle of universal application that operates as a natural limit to the state's ability to tax generally, but including in the mining sector. The ability to tax is at the core of national sovereignty, but a state cannot tax at will without limit. If it tries, its sovereignty will fail. It will no longer be a state. There must be balance. Taxation must accord with some form of justice. This was recognized as early as the 4th century by St. Augustine, who said, in the absence of justice, what is sovereignty but organized robbery? The reality of this limit is a state's ability to tax is a long recognized truth. In 17th century France, Colbert, the French Minister of Finance, acknowledged that taxation had its limits in rather colorful language. He said, the art of taxation consists in so plucking a goose as to obtain the largest amount of feathers with the least possible amount of hissing. I introduce this principle not in terms of geese or feathers, but in terms of sheep shearing. The reason for that is because there is a professor in Pennsylvania who's no longer with us in the last century who had the same idea as Colbert, but expressed it in different words when he said and made this observation. And I quote, in levying taxes and in shearing sheep, it is well to stop when you get down to the skin. So this motion cannot pass. A state cannot tax below the skin of the sheep, or else it risks too much hissing of the metaphorical goose. I turn to the second reason for rejecting this motion, and it lies in multilateral and bilateral treaties and related instruments. I turn first to the multilateral treaty situation, the state-to-state affairs. By subscribing to multilateral trade agreements, states shackle and limit their ability to freely tax and levy customs duties. That is self-evident and is a growing part of life for a state in a global interconnected world. Such agreements can affect the perimeter of taxation and customs in the mining sector. In a worst case scenario, a state can see tax and customs limitations imposed on it via these systems. When one turns next to the bilateral agreement world, the band of bits, private investors and the state, and we've heard much of this today, that does and can and does shackle the ability of states to tax. We've heard about the stabilization clauses, which is perhaps the most precise instrument that gives effect to this limitation on ability to tax. Those states that enter into these agreements freely and of their own accord are thereafter shackled and limited in their ability to tax, and they are commonplace in the mining sector. The motion, therefore, must fail for this reason as well. The final reason is perhaps the most important and potentially far-reaching. It requires one to distinguish the notions of a state and its people. By necessary implication, in the motion under debate, if it is correct that there should be a limit on a state's right to tax in the mining sector, or no limit, I should say, if it's the case that there should be no limit on a state's right to tax in the mining sector, there can be no limit to how the state may deploy the fruits of such taxation. Now, we've heard in how in the post-World War II, from my contradicteur period, in the UN, it was agreed and became established and recognized this international law principle of permanent sovereignty over natural resources. Its genesis, as explained by my contradictor, the driving force was a reaction to colonizing states exploiting colonized states. The principle exists to ensure that developing nations in particular profit properly from their natural resources. Now, in more recent times, the battleground has shifted. We are here today talking about trends in the mining sector in Africa. It's well known that the fruits of certain African natural resources are not finding their way to the people, but instead to select groups in power and the foreign investors. I don't think I'm being contentious in making that observation. In practice, In practice, the international law principle of permanent sovereignty over natural resources is not working very well. The main future battleground, I suggest, will be between the people and their government. And we had hints of this in some of the statements made earlier, the non-presence of government around mining projects. They need to be more present, and the people need them present. The African Charter on Human and People's Rights in the 1980s, ratified by almost all African states, records the principle in the following terms and unambiguously. Article 21, all peoples shall freely dispose of their natural resources. This right shall be exercised in the exclusive interest of the people. In no case shall a people be deprived of it. Based on this principle, the peoples of Africa can legitimately question how their governments tax mining resources and, more importantly, impose limits on their governments. By reason of this principle, a state is not free to enact tax and customs regulation in the mining sector without limit. The motion, as proposed, should therefore fail for this reason as well. And I would simply conclude by observing that this motion could only succeed, I would say, in a world full of perfectly isolated totalitarian states with completely subjugated peoples. No such world exists. I say this motion must therefore fail. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew. I will now turn to our judges in the way they wish, actually, to make either any questions, to put questions to the debaters or to make any observations. The floor is yours. Maybe I don't know, Judge Ogerhoes.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Thank you very much, Clément. First, I would like to say that this principle, this question of tax and custom, well reflects the potential tension between the principle of state sovereignty, the regulatory freedom of the host state on one hand, and the principle of good faith and pacta sunt servanda on the other. I do appreciate actually the reliance of the two speakers, of the two debaters, on the principle of sovereignty on natural resources, as mentioned by the first speaker, by Paris, which was already guaranteed in 1962 by the resolution 1803. You may also go back further in history, you know, in 1958 already, when the eight then independent African states already stated that it was important to allow investment, but at the same time to take care of the independence of and the sovereignty of African states. So the tension was already there in 1958, and it's still today here. So when I say that I appreciate the reliance of both speakers, actually I am more inclined to support the interpretation of Jackwell than the one supported by Titley, Andrew, when he refers to the African Charter. Actually, I find this interpretation of Article 21 of the African Charter very interesting, but I don't buy it, actually. I don't buy it. So this being said, I just wanted to comment at the outset. You know, the question asked has two dimensions in my view. You know, there's the issue of raising the tax and the custom, but there's also the other issue of reducing the tax and issue the tax and customs, reducing, given the fact now that you have more and more non-lowering standards clauses in BITs, which prevent states to do social and human rights dumping. So they might find the taxation issue or the custom question as a manner to attract investment. So I would have liked also you to think and to discuss this aspect of the question, but this we don't have much time to do that. To come back to this principle, which was also enshrined in 1974 in the Charter of Economic Rights and Duties of States, I think that this principle doesn't have any limit, legally speaking, but it has to have a limit, actually. And this, in that way, without going to going back to Saint Augustine and his conception of justice, I think that setting no limit to this principle would undermine the whole construction. There should be, and one of the limit is when states decide to raise the tax or the custom, they have to take care of not undermining the whole thing, the whole construction. And here I refer to the issue of indirect expropriation, which has been dealt with very quickly by Jackwell. I have a question, actually, but I don't know if I can ask it. It's about international responsibility to both speakers. If a state raises its taxes and violate, let's say, BIT, bilateral treaty, or a clause of stabilization, would it be possible to invoke a circumstance precluding wrongfulness, like a state of necessity, for example, or the countermeasure? I raise this question because this issue of a countermeasure was raised before a NAFTA tribunal by Mexico in a case against brought to the ALENA tribunal by two American companies, which were complaining of the rise in tax, 20% rise in taxes concerning syrup sodas. And in its defense, Mexico invoked a countermeasure, saying the US, your home state, has violated international law, has violated a provision of NAFTA, and I am reacting to that. This contention was rejected by the tribunal, but I think it was interesting to see this kind of argument put forward by a state brought before an arbitral tribunal. So if we have time, I would be interested to hear about that from either speakers or from both speakers. I understand that we are under time constraint, so I will stop.
Maybe one or both of you can react if any reaction.
Andrew?
You go, Go ahead, Jacob.
So my view in relation to, so countervailing measures by one state against another state, where if the example you used, Mexico imposed certain taxes and the US had a countervailing measure in terms of similar taxes or customs, whether in a dispute, whether you would be able to rely on that as an investor, I think it's a bit debatable. It's probably you'll have to look at the specific circumstances in relation to your investment in that jurisdiction and how that taxation that is imposed affects your investment, and the test of the significance of the interference by virtue of the conduct or the wrongful act of the state against you as the investor in Mexico. I'm not sure if I answer your question directly, but maybe Andrew can also give it a shot.
I would only add very quickly that I suppose it's the slippery slope, because once one starts self-effectively reacting with another right for, because you've breached one international obligation, and then say, well, I can then make things right by exercising another right in international law. How do you balance that? And you know, that's what tribunals are there for. And I suppose if you have a claim, you make your claim, but you shouldn't be self-righting, if I can call it, indiscriminately. The tribunals, I think, have generally always upheld stabilization clauses. They've always sought to have those stand up because of the core reason given earlier by one of our speakers on the necessity for, you know, la sécurité juridique.
Thank you. Anna, you may have some comments too.
On yes, this. Well, thank you. Thank you, Clément. Well, I must say I'm particularly delighted to be part of this prestigious panel and much honored to share the bench with Judge Falsa Ogerguz. The debaters have been of such a high quality that it will be difficult to decide between them, and they have covered all the topics exhaustively in a very interesting topic, I must say, selected by Clément Fouchard and AfricArb. As mining, we see mining as an ancient and ever-growing activity, giving rise to a lot of arbitration in Africa, often complex cases implying railway or road construction and concessions. And the few questions I would like to put on the table, in addition to those mentioned, would be first about the, of course, the absence of limitation was an opportunity to re-explore the sovereignty of states over their natural resources. But in an arbitration, is the investor challenging the state regulatory right or simply claiming for compensation? We have evoked the fair and equitable treatment. Of course, the sheep and the geese evoked by Andrew cannot claim for compensation, but isn't compensation the common ground for the two debaters on this topic?
Jacqueline?
Maybe one or the other can
thank you, Anna.
Comment on this.
I would think ultimately it will boil down to compensation. So first establishing whether there's a right of an investor that has been violated by the conduct of the state, and with reference to whether there is a concession investment agreement that contains a stabilization provision or a bilateral investment treaty or any other commitment the state has made, maybe in its domestic legislation. Once you've established that, only you can move on to the fact that there should be compensation based on the liability that has been established. So yes, but then obviously there's the whole debate that we've set out with reference to the cases that some tribunals have held. If we look at the Mongolia case, where even where there was windfall profits, that the state imposed, that was within the powers of the state to do so, and the tribunal found nothing wrong in what the government did. So it's a matter of think, assessing the facts and then to get to the compensation part of it. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would agree. It's mostly compensation that one is looking at. I mean, in the most extreme cases, and the UCOS example would be the best, I suppose, where taxation has been as effectively a vehicle of expropriation. It's compensation that you're looking for. And, you know, we did hear earlier, though, that there have tribunals, at least one tribunal, has been ready to order a state to stop taxing in the way it sought to do. For the large part, one is looking for compensation because it's normally come to blows to such a degree by the time you get to the tribunal that's in practice what you're looking for. And of course, enforcing anything else against the state, it has its problems.
Yes, and a correlative question is, of course, and which was treated at the beginning of this debate, maybe in the early as the 1950s, was, is the state abusing its regulatory power? Does it make a difference on the compensation? And the answer was no, except in the systems where an abuse of right can give rise to specific penalty. Now, the second question, which is rather a remark, is about maybe it's provocative, although I'm a judge here and not a debater. It's about the natural resource itself and the terminology. Is the natural resource without an investor still a resource? By the way, the term resource is somewhat misleading. It comes from the French. And the old French verb ressourdre, meaning to rise again, and it's applicable to liquids, especially water. Such minerals, as we are talking about now, do not come to the surface naturally and require, as we all know, sophisticated and costly technology to help them rise again. I would say you have evoked, Jack, well, the 1803 resolution in 1962, even earlier in 1952, when the General Assembly requested the Commission on Human Rights to prepare recommendations concerning the right of people's self-determination, the word wealth was used. And I would prefer this word, wealth in the land, to describe and to be adapted to minds. And I would say a potential wealth that reveals itself through the extractive activity. Now, coming back to Saint Augustin and to the scholastics you have evoked, you remember this phrase, everything that is contractual is fair. And I would like to ask you a question about the balance between the return on investment and sovereign rights on the resource. At this stage of the technology, it often happens that one does not know before digging the soil if the exploitation will be profitable, and if so, to what degree it will be, of course. We have not yet invented the way to scan the earth. On the investor's side, the rate of return, can it be too high? Can it be too low? Where to put the threshold? If it's too high, is it advisable to have, as we see in some contracts, return go back to the state? If it's too low, what is the solution? Also, the return has to be appreciated in which country, in the country where the mining takes place or in the country where the parent company is located. Well, these are a few of the questions I would like to put to the debaters. Maybe Andrew, you want to start?
The return on investment, the relative return on investment, I think, you know, for lawyers at least, this is an extremely difficult question to answer. And, you know, one of the realities of today is that, and the reason I would suggest why states are prepared to sign up to some of these agreements, the stabilization clauses, et cetera, is because, of course, they're competing with other countries and the limited foreign resources to invest in these countries. So there's a certain equilibrium that will be, in theory, if you're someone who studies market forces, should find its equilibrium. But is that the proper equilibrium for the states whose resources are being exploited? Perhaps not. When you look at the competing interests, but it's a question I don't feel qualified to answer, so I think I shall stop there.
Okay.
I would concur with Andrew to say it's more a expert in mining or economics that will be able to give an opinion on that. But it is, as you've pointed out, it's the balancing act. So the thing about investing in mining is every country has different policies. So you have Botswana would say, come and mine in my jurisdiction. I have all these incentives. You have South Africa saying, I have all these incentives. But then once you decide to make that investment decision as an investor, you invest, you spend billions of dollars to sink a shaft. Your investment cost is sunk. So once you're there, it's sunk, you can't move your mine. So it's captive. When these policy changes in government, 10 years after your investment, there's a new government, a new regime. This government has, and we see this in a number of African jurisdictions, whether it's in Tanzania with Barrick Gold, with the renegotiation of the contract, we see it in the DRC. And then the debate is, did the previous government do us in by negotiating certain types of contracts or agreeing to certain types of stabilization provisions? And so it's a difficult one in balancing all of these things, because there will be changes down the line. Each cycle we go through in terms of the type of minerals, whether it's lithium now or platinum later on, will dictate what happens at that particular point in time.
Thank you. Anna, if you agree, I think we should move to the next motion.
Yes.
Given that we are already reached the time we have indicated to or the attendees. So please bear with me. We have a couple of more minutes to have the debaters. So on motion two, which is I read out, an arbitral tribunal should be able to prevent parallel proceedings before national courts involving the investor. To defend the motion, I would ask Guillaume to make his presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Clément. There is no doubt that arbitral tribunals should be able to prevent parallel proceedings. The first reason is that arbitrators have no forum. Quoting Bertrand Goldman, a famous French professor, arbitrators do not have a forum, or if one were to lend them one, it would be the world. So there is no reason why an arbitral tribunal should not be able to prevent parallel proceedings. The second reason why arbitral tribunals should be able to prevent parallel proceedings is that they hold their power from the arbitration agreement. By signing an arbitration agreement, parties expressly agree to denationalize their disputes. Arbitration agreements prevent recourse to state courts. The positive effect of the competence principle means that the arbitration agreement transfers the jurisdiction to hear the dispute from state courts to arbitral tribunals. Everyone can only agree with this principle and its effect. The third reason why arbitral tribunals should be able to prevent parallel proceedings is because they are bound by the principle of celerity. The conduct of the arbitration proceedings in an expeditious manner is one of the main reasons why parties have recourse to arbitration. Article 22.1 of the ICC rules makes it clear that the arbitral tribunals have a duty to make every effort to conduct the arbitration in an expeditious manner. It confers arbitral tribunals the power to take every measure in order to comply with the principle of celerity. This principle is also a means to prevent dilatory tactics from parties who may initiate parallel proceedings to disrupt the arbitration process. It is also true that the principle of celerity referred to in Article 22.1 of the ICC rules applies not only to arbitral tribunals, but also to the parties. In order to comply with this principle of celerity, and because arbitral tribunals have a full knowledge of the dispute, they are best placed to hear all issues arising out of the contract. These procedural arguments demonstrate that arbitral tribunals should be able to prevent parallel proceedings. The same is true regarding to the substance of the disputes. I will take two obvious examples to illustrate my point. Because parties are free to derogate from general principles, arbitral tribunals may also have jurisdiction on tax issues. Tax exemptions may be inserted in a contract as an incentive by the state to an investor. The following provision is crystal clear. The contracting authority agrees to indemnify the investor for any tax owed by the investor in the state which may arise from the contracts. In this case, the arbitral tribunal concluded that this provision creates an obligation by the state to indemnify the investor for any tax due under the contract. In the same way, some bilateral investment treaties give arbitral tribunals the power to decide on tax issues. Most BIT do not include an express provision, such as Article 5 of the BIT concluded between Argentina and New Zealand, which states, the provisions of this agreement shall not apply to matters of taxation in the territory of either contracting party. Now, Article 3.6b of the BIT signed between Brazil and India in 2020 is even clearer. This treaty shall not apply to any law or measure regarding taxation, including measures taken to enforce taxation obligations. So except if there is an express provision excluding taxation from the scope of application of the BIT, arbitral tribunal should have jurisdiction to hear taxation disputes. This is the fourth reason why an arbitral tribunal should be able to prevent parallel proceedings. The fifth reason is no longer disputed in both commercial and investment arbitration. Arbitral tribunals have full jurisdiction to handle issues of corruption. Indeed, arbitral tribunals have the power to investigate and to audition people to determine corruption allegations. There are numerous examples in both commercial and investment arbitration where arbitral tribunals have examined allegations of corruption. Just to give one example in investment arbitration, we can refer to the decision and jurisdiction rendered by the ICSID tribunal in Nickel Resources versus BAPEX and Petro Bangla in August 2013. In this decision, the arbitral tribunal concluded that it must examine whether any instance of bribery and corruption in which a claimant has been or may have been involved deprives the claimant from having its claims considered and ruled upon by the present tribunal. The decision on jurisdiction has been followed by a decision on the corruption claim in February 2019. As guardians of the protection of the international public order, arbitrators have the power to determine corruption allegations. This has been confirmed by a very recent ruling of the Singapore International Commercial Court. In its ruling of 10th September 2021, the Singapore International Commercial Court held that arbitrators have a public duty to review evidence of corruption presented to them. For the reasons described above, arbitral tribunals should be able to prevent parallel proceedings. This view is not controversial and is widely held. In fact, almost all share this view. It is very much true that the notion of arbitral legal order, used for the first time by Professor Daniel Cohen as early as 1993, has been proved valid time and time again. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Guillaume. And thank you for being on time, it will give even more time to Amani and the rest of the speakers. So Amani, sorry, but Amani will have 7 minutes, of course, no more. The floor is yours then.
Thank you, Clément. I won't use Guillaume's extra time, don't worry. In fact, I don't think I'm going to use all of my allotted time. Before I start, you know, I just wanted to confirm the point that you made, that none of the views I'm about to express are attributable to me or to anyone else. I'm just simply trying to do a bad job advocating a position for the purposes of this debate. I'm going to make three brief points to explain why I think the arbitral tribunals should not be empowered to prevent parallel proceedings before national courts involving the investor. At a high level, my first point relates to the definition of parallel proceedings. You simply can't know whether proceedings are really parallel or not without airing the issues first. This militates in favor of allowing parties to bring proceedings in their elected forum and then allowing that forum to determine the extent of any overlap with the other proceedings. My second point is that the balance of prejudices militates in favor of allowing parties access to the forum, which they choose based on the jurisdictional rules that apply in that forum. And my third and final point is that it is an excess of a tribunal's powers to go the extra step of preventing a party from accessing a forum that would otherwise have jurisdiction, and where states have elected to kind of streamline their dispute resolution procedures in a treaty, they're at liberty to include a fork in the road provision. And Guillaume's made a number of really excellent points about all the things that arbitral tribunals can do, and there's no doubt that they can do them, but there's still a significant degree of difference in the various powers and the relief that you can get before national courts. So they're not exactly sort of parallel remits, if you will. And that takes me to my first point, which is really that there's no generally accepted definition of what parallel proceedings actually are, although the ILA does define concurrent proceedings as proceedings pending before a domestic court or another arbitral tribunal in which parties and one or more of the issues are the same or substantially the same as the ones before the arbitral tribunal in the arbitration. And despite Guillaume's excellent attempt to fudge the issue, it's trite law that proceedings before national courts and arbitral tribunals are different because they're applying, for the most part, different substantive protections. So typically a national court may be concerned with contractual or tortious claims under national laws, whereas international investment tribunals are applying treaty protections, hopefully, as interpreted and applied by other international tribunals. So put differently, treaty claims and contract claims don't have the same cause of action. And it's questionable, therefore, whether investment arbitration proceedings and national court proceedings can ever truly be parallel in the same way as, for example, a party commencing multiple arbitrations under the same arbitration clause in a private contract, requesting the same relief. So I think that there's an inherent difference there. And I think peeling back some of Guillaume's excellent points, I think one point where I do agree with him is, you know, the risk that, well, the concern that tribunals often have that a party might be seeking to abuse the system by claiming double recovery from the same loss. However, in practice, it's rare to encounter a party that's made a huge windfall from parallel proceedings, sort of living it up at nightclubs and bars in Paris off the proceeds of their huge windfall. And I think this is because the respective fora are sophisticated enough to take the simple point that the claimant has already been paid or has a right to be paid under enforceable award at the quantum stage. You don't need to go to the extra unnecessary step of nannying the other forum in case they get it wrong. If this weren't the case, I'm sure you would see a lot more businesses trying to monetize this potential loophole in the international legal system. My point is simply, if they could, they would have already. There would probably be an app for it, in fact. My second point, which I'm going to make briefly, is that prevention here is worse than the disease. So my husband now hates lockdowns and he gets very agitated when he's forced to spend a large amount of time with me in a confined space. And I'm trying not to take this too personally. His point is, in his darkest moments, that prevention, which entails being in a confined space with me, is worse than the risk of contracting the disease. The same might be said of granting an injunction to prevent parallel proceedings in cases involving an investor before national courts. The effect of an injunction is to prevent even the threshold question of whether proceedings are truly parallel from even being aired. As I said, it's not always obvious whether proceedings are truly parallel, and it requires an investigation. And seeing as how different fora have different spheres of influence, each forum is best placed to determine whether there's been a breach of the standards that it's bound to apply. It's both paranoid and pessimistic to assume that national courts can't figure this out. The risk is here that a trigger-happy tribunal may grant an injunction without ever fully appreciating the nature and scope of the national court proceedings or the role of the court in a particular case. And so it's prudent to err on the side of caution and to allow the courts to decide for themselves. The tribunal can always decide the impact, if any, of any judgment that results from those proceedings independently. That risk outweighs any potential efficiency gains that would be achieved by gagging a party to prevent access to courts. My third and final point, which I'm going to make very briefly,
1 minute,
in less than a minute, is that parties to investment treaties already have a very good way of preventing the inefficient use of resources, although from the lawyer's perspective, that's often to our benefit, which is the fork in the road provision, which allows claimants to choose at the outset the best forum for pursuing their claim. In the absence of such a provision, a tribunal can't truly know whether the state parties intended or indeed consented to limit any access to one or other forum. So, you know, and if there's no provision in the treaty, I think it would be foolish of a tribunal to second guess that. Is my brief point, and I'll stop there.
Thank you, Amani. Well, now I'm turning to the judges, and maybe you may limit yourself to observations. I would. Fear a little bit some another row of questions and answers. Sorry about that. But yes, observations and comments would be much welcome. I don't know, Judge Ogarkus, maybe?
Yes, actually, I would start with the end of the presentation of Amani when she spoke about the fork in the road concept. And I agree very much with her to say that when there is such a limitation in the treaty, in the BIT, asking the investor to choose between the two and not to be able to change if he starts with the national courts, I think that the arbitral tribunal has already, it's not that the arbitral tribunal should be able, the arbitral tribunal must actually drop, because the investor has chosen one way instead of the other one. In the second example, where the situation is very clear, it's when there's a renunciation clause preventing the investor to go to international arbitration if it has it. I mean, asking the investor to waive its right to go to a national court if he wants to seize an international tribunal. Actually, this is the situation in the NAFTA convention, chapter 11, NAFTA agreement, chapter 11. The other thing, I mean, if I should summarize my position, because I had another commitment at 5:30, I would be more in favor of the position for the court, the arbitral tribunal to prevent, because I don't like this showroom copying. I think we should prevent, the tribunal should prevent forum shopping. But at the same time, I am very much sensitive to the argument of Amani again, when she says, what is a parallel proceeding? And she mentioned the treaty-based claims together aside the contract-based claims. And it's very difficult sometimes to distinguish, because you don't have most of the time you don't have the same cause. The provision is different. The provision is different. So you cannot distinguish between the two. So at one stage, you have to leave the two proceedings go together, go in the same, I mean, to proceed. Actually, I have other comments, but I would like to ask one question, if I may ask one question. If the arbitral tribunal decide to prevent the investor to entertain parallel proceedings before a national court, what if the investor doesn't abide by the order of the tribunal, because it should be by order, by provisional measures, by interim measures? What will be the consequence for the investor if he doesn't abide by the decision of the arbitral tribunal, the international arbitral tribunal, not to pursue the proceedings before the national arbitral tribunal?
Who wants to try? Amani?
Sure. Yeah, no, I think it's a super interesting question. Because
I'm conscious that you have also commitment, so feel free to answer and then leave.
Okay, no, it's fine. I can stay a few more minutes. No, I think it's a super interesting question. It often comes up in a commercial arbitration context, in the context of an anti-suit injunction. Mm-hmm. And really, you know, there's a limit to what the tribunal can do practically, especially if the court doesn't, in that specific jurisdiction, won't recognize the tribunal's order, which, it's fair to say that some courts could be quite hostile to an order such as that. So I think it's for each tribunal to decide in the case, you know, what they can do, if anything, really, in practice, to enforce compliance with that order.
Thank you. I would probably now just ask Anna to sort of make comments and conclusions.
Yes.
At the same time.
Well, thank you very much, Clément. Well, again, very high quality debaters who have covered brilliantly the topics and exhaustively. We have seen the anti-suit injunctions. The dilatory tactics, of course, that we see more and more often. A question might be within the question, as a form of a comment, should a distinction be made between parallel proceedings in the host state and in another state? Now, on the very interesting issue of the waiver clauses, which have appeared rather recently, I would say around the, we have seen this in the US model BIT of 2004, inter alia, the fork in the road clauses, which have been also quite recent in the arbitration history, CMS versus Argentina in supervision, e-control versus Costa Rica, where the clause was analyzed. I would like to recall how we did before, and we have seen, of course, in the 19th century, a defiance towards arbitration. But since then, we have had the investment dispute construction, the ICSID, and I would like to just recall that that Article 26 of the ICSID Convention provides that consent of the parties to arbitration under this convention shall, under otherwise stated, be deemed consent to such arbitration to the exclusion of any other remedy, which was commented by the report in the report of the executive directors on the convention, stating that it is presumed that when a state and investor agree to have recourse to arbitration, the intention of the parties is to have recourse to arbitration to the exclusion of any other remedy. But again, this is a very interesting debate. And next time, Clément, because the subject was absolutely perfect, but please provide more time for the questions and answer. And thank you again, everyone, the debaters and panelists and attendees for this session.
Thank you, everyone. I will not add to anything, just thanking you for attending the session. And yes, promise next time we'll maybe split into parts, given the depth of our subjects. Thanks again to all the speakers, and I wish you the best Paris Arbitration Week possible. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.